السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على محمد الأمين إمام المرسلين خاتم النبيين وسيد ولد آدم أجمعين وعلى أهله وصحبه أجمعين والتابعين إلى يوم الدين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. وقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: اقرأوا القرآن فإنه يأتي يوم القيامة شفيعا لأصحابه، أو كما قال رسول الله. ونسأل الله أن يجعلنا من الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. الحمد لله. We thank and we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this very blessed day. We thank and we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for allowing us to live from the moment of our conception to this exact second, for granting us so many privileges, so many things that we take for granted, for granting us things that which we know of and that which we know not. And we pray that Allah make us among those who will be grateful for these blessings. We thank and we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for allowing us to witness. Not only did we witness the end of Ramadan, not only did we celebrate Eid after Ramadan, but here we are on another Friday after Ramadan. We thank and we praise Allah, and we ask that Allah allow us to see many more to come. We pray for peace and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his family, his companions, and those who will follow him upon the path of righteousness until the day of Deen. Amen. I begin with a message of gratitude, a reminder of gratitude. Because without being grateful, without truly understanding how blessed we are as Muslims, how blessed we are as human beings, period, it will be very difficult to recognize how much we are supposed to worship Allah, or how sincere we should be in our worship towards Allah. As I mentioned in the beginning, Ya أَيُّوَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا تَقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِ. We want to worship Allah the way He deserves to be worshipped, but how can you do so if you do not even begin to understand how complex is the blessings that Allah has given us? The human body is made up of millions and millions and millions of cells. And each cell is carrying out so many different processes within each second. It takes almost 30 million different calculations for the body just to blink an eye. And that's not the only thing going on. Your heart is pumping, working together with the lungs. The bones is producing calcium. Your stomach is digesting, the intestines filtering, you have the kidneys, all of these things is going on. Your brain is controlling everything, the spine, helping delivering the messages. All of these things go on without your own effort. Alhamdulillah, Allah did not place it in our hands for us to control all of this. My brothers and sisters, just handling the bills at home is stressful. Imagine having to handle the bills of your body. Imagine having to handle the processes. Imagine having to sit there and manually tell yourself, okay, heart, pump blood, lungs, yes, the oxygen, brain, can you please deliver dopamine to this part of the brain? This part of my knees is hurting. I need some calcium over there right now. Oh, we're lacking acid. Can we back? Imagine having to do that all by yourself. But we don't have to do that. MashaAllah, Allah blessed us so much that even when we go to sleep, the process is carrying on. When was the last time you thanked Allah for this? Allah gave you this body and gave it so many wonders. How do you treat your body? Do you take care of your body as a Muslim? If we do not have a good answer for this, then how can we begin to say we are going to worship Allah the way He deserves to be worshipped? We ask that Allah make us among those who take care of ourselves and recognize the blessings of Allah. But to move on to the main topic, which will actually relate to what we just talked about. Alhamdulillah, we just finished Ramadan. Before Ramadan, we stood here and we talked about how we're going to prepare for Ramadan. During Ramadan, we stood here and we talked about the benefits, the blessings, the things we want to make sure we do before Ramadan ends. And then now that we are here post-Ramadan, after Ramadan, my brothers and sisters, there is a very important reminder that I have. This reminder is so simple. It's something that I should have to remind you about. Or it's not something new. I'm not coming to say here that, oh, yo, mashallah, I never thought of that. It's something we know. So simple. But wallahi, we don't think about it often. And that if we do not pay attention or be careful, we will end up in a very bad position on the day of judgment. My brothers and sisters, we mentioned during Ramadan. Ramadan is a 30-day training for what is going to come after. My brothers and sisters, please listen carefully. The same Lord you worship during Ramadan is the same Lord after Ramadan. When you said, Ya Allah, when the Imam was doing a dua during the night, and he made the dua, and we stand and we face the heavens, we raise our hands, we say, Ameen, or we say, Ya Rabb, or we say, Ya Allah. It's the same Allah after Ramadan. So then why are we stopping what we started to do during Ramadan? Why? The purpose of Ramadan is to increase what you did not do before. How can we afford to downgrade ourselves after Ramadan when that is when we need it the most? If you pay attention to ibadah, the reward you get from ibadah is increased. That is incentive for us to do it more, and when you do it more, it becomes a habit. Why are we dropping the habit now? Why are we downgrading ourselves as Muslims? You have an internet service plan at home, right? A Wi-Fi plan, whether it's with Verizon or AT&T, you agree that for a certain amount of megabytes per second, you are going to pay this price. And you know, mashallah, some of us are enjoying the gigabyte service. You know, mashallah, I worked a little bit with Verizon, we are familiar. The gigabyte service is providing you, I think, about 1,065 megabytes per second. You type www.youtube.com in less than a second, it loads up. And mashallah, we pray, you know, we pay a certain amount of money for this fast internet. Some of us are paying up to $200 per month just for Wi-Fi service. MashaAllah, if you are willing to pay this much, it would not be unreasonable for me to tell you, you know, $200, you know, if you can downgrade back to just 500 megabytes or 300 megabytes, and you know, that extra $100, go use it to feed somebody on the street. That's not unreasonable for me to tell you. But no, I'm pretty sure we are all comfortable not downgrading our internet service so we can enjoy better quality of internet. If you are not willing to downgrade your internet service, why are you willing to downgrade your deen? Why are you willing to step down from the fast speed ibadah that you was doing during Ramadan and reduce it back to what you was doing before? Do not become a Ramadan Muslim. You should be a Muslim all year round. You should increase what you did not do before Ramadan, and you should not decrease what you do after Ramadan. That way, every Ramadan is a gradual increase. And we're not saying after Ramadan you should remain, you know, like a saint, like the you, like as if you are the Imam of Mecca. No. All we are saying is, if you are praying, if you are putting in all that effort, why stop? Now, if you do stop, because it's not easy. And that's the conversation that I feel like when we talk about these things, we don't bring up. It's not easy. So I would like to begin with this. If you are sitting here and prayer was difficult for you, and during Ramadan you were inspired, you felt comfortable, you felt, Ramadan, I must pray. I want to congratulate you. And I want to tell you that I am proud of you. MashaAllah, that you began to pray during Ramadan. We're not saying that's a bad thing. Now the goal, the mission, is to try to retain it. Even if it means that you will do it little by little. This is what I mean. If before Ramadan you was not praying at all, the only thing Muslim about you was your name. And then during Ramadan you started coming to the masjid. Okay, after Ramadan, just come to the Friday prayers, please. Try your best that the Friday prayers, my life depends on it. I'm not gonna miss it. Okay, once you start getting comfortable with the Friday prayers, you come and you hear the word of Allah, you find yourself among Muslim brothers, assalamu alaikum, you hug each other, you start to feel the love. Okay, let me carry it on. Try to start praying Dhuhr or Asr. Among all the prayers, Dhuhr or Asr is like the easiest to pray. Why? Fajr, you have to wake up early in the morning. I don't want to disturb my sleep. Isha, you tired, it's the end of the day, I'd rather go to bed. Maghrib is usually also around during the evening, either you're about to eat or you're coming back home from work. But Dhuhr and Asr around 12 or 5 p.m., you can kind of just push that into whether you're taking a break from work or whether you just finished work, there's a masjid right around the corner, you just go, you pray for a rakah, you go home. Among all the prayers, these two are the easiest to pray. So pick one and start doing it consistently. So now after Ramadan, before Ramadan, you was not praying. After Ramadan, you come into Friday prayers and now you're praying Dhuhr or Asr. After a few weeks, then you add Asr or Dhuhr, whichever one you was not doing. So now you're praying Jum'ah, Dhuhr, Asr. After a few weeks, you add Fajr, you know? One of my teachers told me that the signs of a strong man is not the one who can fight everybody, but the one who can fight the covers of the bed. The one who can fight his own pillow and wake up to pray Fajr. I remember telling my teacher, you know, I feel like the age I'm at and, you know, the things I got going on, I think I'm ready to get married. He said, how easy it is for you to wake up for Fajr? I said, it's not easy. He said, you're not ready to get married. And my fathers here can teach me and explain what this really means. May Allah make it easy for us. So little by little, this is what I mean. I'm not saying after Ramadan, your performance needs to be high, exceptional, perfect. No. After Ramadan, you struggle and you ask Allah to help you. And you know, mashallah, after sitting down and contemplating the way Allah works, there is an ayah in the Quran that I always talk about, but it goes so much deeper than we actually look at it. The ayah in the Quran where Allah says, He does not change a people until they change themselves. So then I realized when I make dua, I say, Ya Allah, give me money. But after looking at that ayah, I think the right dua I should be saying, Ya Allah, give me the courage to get money. Ya Allah, give me the wisdom to get money. Ya Allah, rid me of laziness so that I will be able to wake up early in the morning and put in energy into my business or my profession so I can make more money. Because we don't just ask and it falls from the tree. So the same way, when we are making our dua and we standing and we was crying, you ask Allah to give you the taqwa, the iman, the courage. It takes courage to show your face in the masjid when people know that you will not always come to the masjid. It takes courage to even show your face to Allah. Some of us are not praying because we feel so embarrassed. How can I stand in front of Allah and say Allahu Akbar when I wasn't doing it 365 days before? But my brother, my sister, Allah is always willing to accept you. As we know in the hadith of Qudsi, when you take a few steps towards Allah, Allah comes running towards you. SubhanAllah, what a Lord. As high and as mighty as Allah is still willing to love us this way. We ask that Allah continues to love us. We ask that we earn the love of Allah. So please do not become Ramadanis, but please become Muslims all year around. And you do not have to be perfect, but rather you're trying to maintain the practices that you were doing during Ramadan. So we learned a few things during Ramadan and we want to, you know, continue these things. One of these things we learned was patience. During Ramadan, we are encouraged to be patient. As we all know, we know the famous hadith or the famous line that when somebody provokes you, you say, "You are lucky that I'm fasting." Right? You know, somebody provokes us and they're really trying to start with you, and you know, every time they're trying to try you, you're lucky I'm fasting right now. Well, after Ramadan, you should change the phrase and say, "You're lucky I'm a Muslim." It should be the same energy. Not after Ramadan that you're gonna pick up back your temper and then now you wanna tussle with everyone. No. What I said, Ramadan is a 30-day training for the next 11 months to come. You were patient during Ramadan. You were abstaining from saying certain things during Ramadan. Before, when the wife would say something, you would argue, but then during Ramadan, you would maintain the peace in the house. Let it continue. And you will only benefit, and you will never decrease. And this is the beautiful thing about Islam. Every single rule, every single legislature, every single thing that Allah asks us to do, there is absolutely no way you can lose from doing it. And the only thing that will happen is that you will increase. If you are a business person, you know this is the best deal you can make. Because when it comes to business, and life is a business, when it comes to business, almost every move has its profit, but then it also has its thing that is going to take away from the company. So when you are investing money, for example, the benefit is that the long-term cost is going to pay off. But then the things that you don't like is that it is reducing from the capital that you have now. That when I buy this expensive machine to improve the quality, now I'm broke. But at least now I'm going to be able to produce more quality services. But when it comes to the business of Allah, when it comes to this deed, there is absolutely no way you can lose, you will only benefit. All the way down to even giving zakat, to even giving feces in that. When you take out $10 from your pocket right now, when they say feces in that after we finish praying, you remove a 10 and you give it, you did not decrease. You just made a down payment towards the Jannah. And Allah will give you that money back in this dunya. So free money here and free Jannah in the hereafter, you did not decrease. Allah asks us to be patient, there is no way you decrease. As a person who is patient, people will have no choice but to eventually respect you. Because even as a person, right, for instance, if you and I are arguing, I take my voice here, you take your voice here. Even if I am in the wrong, I can use the fact that you were screaming at me against you. And we see this all the time. People use a straw man argument all the time. Oh, and you took my money and you don't want to give it back to me. What's wrong with you? What's wrong with you? Look at how you're talking to me. You see? Now they're using your own thing against you. But if you were patient, if you were patient with the way you address them, if you are patient in the way you deal with people, people will have no choice but to address their own faults, and they will have nothing against you. We built this habit during Ramadan. Please, for the sake of Allah, my brothers and sisters, do not drop it. Remember to be patient. Fasbir sabran jameela. Now here's the second part of this advice, the one that you did not expect. Patience is not only with people. Be patient with yourself. My brothers and sisters, be patient with who? Yourself. How do you be patient with yourself? It goes back to what I just mentioned. Do not expect perfection from yourself. You are a human being. You will make mistakes. When you make these mistakes, please be patient with yourself. Do not get angry. And this is an advice that the Muslim youth really need to hear. Because I can promise you, as young people, we have so much pressure on us that when we make mistakes, we don't forgive ourselves. And when we don't forgive ourselves, this is what is pushing us towards our mental problems. And we start to get depressed, and we start to get anxiety, and we start to hate ourselves, and we hate everything about myself, and I hate that I'm Muslim because I'm supposed to pray, but I don't feel like praying. Why do I feel like this? Be patient with yourself. You do not become perfect over the day. The Sahaba were the worst people on earth. The worst. So bad that when they gave birth to a girl, they will bury the little child, the little girl alive because they wanted a son. But these are the same people that after they accepted Islam and gradually, look at how Allah deals with the Muslims. Gradually, the ayat of legislature were, Allah did not just drop, oh, this is what a Muslim is supposed to be. And then the next day, everybody was supposed to adapt it. It was little by little. You pray this much times a day. You treat people this way. You give people this type of respect. You give women their rights. You do not take alcohol. Even the ayah that prohibits alcohol was brought down gradually. Don't drink it when you're about to pray. Perhaps it will be better if you don't drink it, than don't drink it at all. So if Allah is willing to be patient with you, why not be patient with yourself? So please, be patient with yourself. Be patient with who? With yourself. If you make a mistake, no problem. Astaghfirullah wa atubu ilayh. Make a sincere repentance towards Allah, and then you get back on track. Because we don't have space for, you know what, I don't, what's the point, man? I'm just gonna go back to the alcohol. I'm just gonna go back to not praying. What's the point? No. As Muslims, we can't afford to be making these type of decisions. Because there is so much on us right now that we need to do. You perfecting your Islam is representative of the whole Ummah. So please, as a young Muslim, or as a Muslim in general, I need you to understand this. Do not see yourself as a common person. Do not see yourself as, oh, I'm just a Bubakar just walking around. I'm not Mufti, man. Mufti, man, mashallah, he's traveling, he's giving lectures, you know, what other imams like Zaki Naik or whatever da'is we know, and they're on the screens and the videos are going viral. I'm not him. I don't really matter. No. You are just as important to this deed as Mufti Mek or any other imam out there giving da'i. Why? Because your actions is still representative of Islam. Your co-worker at work, they're not watching Mufti Mek. Who they watching? They're watching you. Our brothers and sisters outside right now. Now when I say outside, I mean like downstairs. Like next to the library, they see us coming to come and pray Jumu'ah. It's gonna spark curiosity. Yo, every Friday I'm seeing these Muslims, they're wearing some weird long garments and, yo, what is that on your hat, bro? Like, what y'all doing over there? Eventually people is gonna get curious. We want to be ready and show them what the deen is actually about. And this is why you must be patient with yourself. Because we need you. No, Allah needs you to be your best. And when you are your best, then you are able to prove that the Muslim Ummah can also be their best. And this is why we must remain patient with ourselves. We ask that Allah make us among those who remain patient. Another thing that we learned during Ramadan that we must maintain, reading the Quran. Please, I cannot stress how important this is. The Quran. We have left the Quran for only the students in the masjid. We left knowledge of the Quran for only the imams. Back then, when they used to give lectures on Quran, almost everybody sitting down listening to the lecture have memorized Quran. And when I say memorize Quran, they're not students. The baker, the carpenter, the farmer, they all memorized it. Because back then, the value of the Quran was so high. Today, we don't value Quran so bad that it's only during Ramadan we pick up the Quran. that you hear that they ask him, oh, where did I put the Quran again? It's been a long time. They pick up the Quran and they have to dust off the Quran. Please, let us not fall back into the same mistake. Now that Ramadan is over, continue to read the Quran. As I mentioned in the hadith when we began, the Quran will literally come on the day of judgment and intercede on your behalf. Imagine after all the things you need to use, each and every single one of us, we are heading towards the day of judgment with an account. I like to call it a bank account. Right? And we're going to go to Allah, and there is a certain amount of money or rewards required to get into Jannah. If you are going to use this bank account and try to get in, some of us will fall short. And that is when the Quran will be able to step in and say, you know, your slave, he used to read me all the time. And then Allah will grant you Jannah on behalf of the Quran. Do we not want this? It sounds as if like, oh, so all I gotta do is read the Quran? Yes. After maintaining your duties as a Muslim, which you are supposed to do already, literally, just read the Quran and you will see what will happen. And reading the Quran does nothing but bring peace to your own heart. One of my favorite students, a student that I like to talk about all the time, is this young girl. She came to the masjid, she barely covers up, she doesn't want, the only reason why she came to the masjid was because her friend was at the masjid and she needed to come and get her metro card. And when she came upstairs and the girl said, oh, Ustaz, look, this is my friend, and she don't come to the masjid, but she's also Muslim. I said, oh, you're Muslim? MashaAllah. Oh, okay. Why you don't want to come? She said, I don't want to come to the masjid. There's too many people looking at me. I don't want to have to. The people be judging you. I don't want to have to. I said, no problem. You can come and see me after everybody has gone home. We're going to discuss what we can do. And of course, we made sure, you know, we're in the masjid. This is a sister. I am a brother. We did it in public space with everybody seeing what's going on. But the next week, MashaAllah, she came. Like I said, people will always be curious. Even our Muslim brothers and sisters that we see outside, they're not praying. Do not think that they have given up on the deen. A huge part of them really wants to like learn Islam really bad. And like I said, you know, every time I stand here, I have to tell you the truth. If I don't come and say the truth and I sugarcoat things, I do not deserve to stand here. So here's another truth, if I'm going to be honest. As Muslim leaders, teachers, imams, we are doing a terrible job with getting the people who are outside coming into the masjid. We are only focusing on the people in the masjid. Why? I'm telling you, all these brothers and sisters outside drinking and smoking and whatnot, they haven't prayed for a long time, they want to learn about Islam. Why are we giving up on them? And these are the same people, once they receive Islam, they are hard working on the deen more than the people who were even born Muslims. More than the people who grew up with Islam in their houses. So why are we giving up on them? So please, do not give up on the people who want to learn more about Islam, or the people who we see they have left Islam. They want to learn, it is just difficult for them to come. They just need somebody to grab their hand and bring them in. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of the rest. We ask that Allah makes among those who will bring people to Islam. And if we are among those who don't have Islam, we ask that Allah give us the Islam to begin with. So this young girl, she comes to the masjid, she says, you know, I want to learn the Quran and I want to do this, but it just seems like so much. I said, go and practice Fatiha. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Malik Yawmiddin. Go practice that. You're going to come, I'm going to correct the mistakes you make during that, you're going to take it from there. I didn't tell her, oh, you know, astaghfirullah, look at how you dress. I just told her, just practice that. Come, let's talk. She came the next week, we sat down, we corrected her fatiha. The next week after that, mashallah, she's reading Fatiha with no mistakes. The more she was coming to the masjid, she was observing the way people dress. I did not have to tell her by herself. She began to dress properly. This is how the da'wah works, especially with the youth of today. You know, because, and I'm going to be honest as a young person, because we have access to technology, right? And let me tell you something. I don't think you guys really understand how powerful the internet is. An imam was giving a lecture. Every hadith, every ayah, every story he mentioned, before he finishes it, I was able to search it on Google and pull it up and show me this one, right? He said, yo, wait, did you memorize all of it? I said, I've never heard the story you mentioned in my whole life. Now, how are you able to pull it up so quick? You just gotta know what to search. And if you know how to search on Google, there is a class on how to search on Google. People don't know this. If you know how to use your keywords right, you're gonna find exactly what you need to find. And as a college student, this is very useful. So as a young person, I'm gonna be honest with you. Because we have access to the internet, we have access to so much knowledge, us as a generation, we have become very much, you know, I know. Oh, you know, you don't do this, man. It's not good for you. I know what you're talking about. I didn't watch a YouTube video on that last week. You know, mashallah, one of the seven benefits of praying Quran or praying Salat on time is, yeah, I know. I really watched the Mufti Man lecture on last week. We've become very much, you know, we know. So when you want to give advice to young people, you don't come and try to correct their behavior. You shift their attention towards another behavior, and then the environment around that behavior eventually will change them. This is how you get the Muslim youth back to the deen. This is why, if you want to see the success of the Muslim youth, give them positions of leadership in the community, in the masjid. During Ramadan, when it comes to food, the Muslim youth should be taking care of everything. Because they are going to look at themselves before they go to sleep. I'm the one who's in charge of making sure people drink water in the masjid. You know, maybe tomorrow let me wear a kufi before I go to the masjid. You know, just to look more official. I have such a huge responsibility. And you have to let them understand how important the position is. It's not just giving water. Every person that takes a sip of water and break their fast, you get the reward of their fast. This is a very huge position. You are in charge of sharing the bread. You are in charge of cleaning the masjid. You're in charge of this. You're in charge of that. Give the young people these positions in the masjid. If they have knowledge, let them lead the prayer sometimes. Let them teach. As you start to give young people these positions, they themselves will recognize, I cannot continue my old ways and I have this position. I can't go outside and I'm on the block doing this and that, and then I have to come and do this in the masjid. They themselves are going to start to change. If you think about it, that is the purpose of Ramadan. Ramadan places you in such an ibadah intense environment that you yourself start to change. It's the same concept. So please, to go back to the main thing I was talking about, the young girl. So with this, little by little, a year went by, 2 years went by, 3 years in, this young girl is my best student. And my own student inspired me. You know how she inspired me? She has this very big Quran that she brings to the masjid. And the Quran, the masjid that we are in, Masjid Siddiq, there's a lot of kids. So if you're not careful, Qurans are very difficult to get. That's why people are advised to bring your own Quran. Because if you want to depend on a Muslim Quran, you're not going to get one. So one day she made the mistake of leaving her Quran down on a table. She went to use the bathroom and came back, and the Quran was gone. My brothers and sisters, the same sister that years ago did not come to the masjid and did not care anything about Islam, The only thing Muslim about her was her name. And she didn't even feel like learning about Islam. This was the same sister that when she found out that her Quran was taken, she came to me crying. I can't find my Quran. This Quran means everything to me. If I don't find this Quran, I will never be at peace. And when I saw her crying, I started to cry. Why? Because if I'm going to be honest with myself, I never cried over the Quran. I've panicked when I lost my phone. Oh yeah, when I lost my wallet, what am I going to do? But I've never panicked over losing my Quran. If I can't find my Quran, it's just, I'll just get another one. SubhanAllah. Even my own student ended up teaching me. So I'm saying all of this to say, be patient with yourself and read the Quran. You will be surprised to see how much the Quran will transform you. So that is one of the habits. We talked about what? Being patient with the people, being patient with yourself, with your own self-development. And we talked about reading the Quran. For the sake of time, we're going to mention one last thing. And we kind of just got into it already, the Muslim youth and the community in general. One of the most beautiful things about Ramadan is that the community comes together. Why stop this after Ramadan? Do you know how powerful we are together as Muslims? Have you ever looked around on a day of Eid? Have you ever took a moment to just stop on a day of Eid and just see the amount of Muslims around you? And that is from only one Muslim. Imagine that Eid was 6-7 Muslims prayed together. How many people is that? Imagine all of these people come together and sign a petition, or come together and sign to the mayor or to the borough president. Look, as a Muslim community, as a community of Muslims, we lack this in our community. This is what we need from the government. Because other people are doing it. Other communities, they gather the people, they come together, they sign forms, they sign this and that, because the government have, you know, they have huge amounts of money set aside for this purpose. But as a Muslim community, some of us are still figuring out how to stand next to each other during prayer. But with Ramadan, we saw that it is possible. You cannot tell me that uniting the Ummah is impossible. Look at Ramadan. Look at how many people finally come together. On the day of Eid, look at how many people are standing next to each other. If we can do it then we can do it now. So let us continue that sense of community. Let us put aside our differences. Let us come together. Let us plan. Let us make effort. And a part of this planning, the planning for the Muslim youth. One person alone cannot plan for the future of the whole Muslim youth. It is going to be a collective effort. It is going to require all of us to come together and sit down and say, what do we want for our Muslim youth? And I'm going to put this question, and I need you to ask yourself this. In the next 5 years, all of us sitting here right now, either you have children, or you have siblings, you have little brothers and sisters. In the next 5 years, where are they? What are they doing? I don't want a vague answer like, oh, mashallah, they're doing good in school, they're in college, right by now, this time. No, specifically. Like, I mean, if we have a list of the Muslim youth, child number one, Muhammad Ibrahim, what is he doing? Child number two, Musa Ismail, what is he like? We need to know specifically, what are we doing? Are these set of students, are they going to go into medicine? Are we going to have these kids go into engineering? We live in an automated world today. Where are the students learning coding, learning information technology? Most of the jobs in the future from now are going to be online or automated. Where is our future in that? Where's our future in that? We need to plan for this.
we need to push the Muslim youth in positions that will set them forth for success. We're not just gonna wake up every morning and then we send them off to school, because the school for nowadays, let's be honest, the school is a babysitting service for us. We don't care what they're doing in school. As long as we have something to keep them busy while I go to work, then you're fine. With this mentality, we cannot develop the Muslim youth. We need to develop them. Choose specific students. You're gonna go and study this. You're gonna learn leadership. You're gonna learn. And not all the kids have to become imams. Now they have to memorize Quran. Let us make that a norm. We've made memorizing. If we tell our children, yeah, my son, I want you to memorize the Quran, immediately they start thinking, this guy wants to make me a whole imam. I'm not trying to be an imam, bro. I play basketball. I'm trying to be a basketball player who memorizes the Quran. We just heard about, is it Kyrie? Kyrie just converted to Islam. Imagine if he memorized the Quran. And we pray that inshallah he will. Imagine the source of that one he will become. Imagine post-game. After the game, the interview, when they sit down, imagine you're talking about your team's performance and then you use an ayah from the Quran. As you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this kaza, this is why my team, we put it in all our effort. Imagine the da'wah from that. This is possible in all fields of life. So with the Muslim youth, after Ramadan, let us try to still focus on them. Give them Quran, give them deen. Show them how the deen is beneficial to their life. I talked about this last time. You want the best business advice? Come to Islam. Islam will tell you how to maximize your company and maximize your profits. Because Islam, when Allah says that the deen covers all aspects of life, it covers all aspects of life. Not just standing in the masjid and then we pray and we believe. We ask that Allah to make things easy for us. We ask that Allah give us the ability to accomplish all of this.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah wa ala ahlihi wa sahbihi. Alhamdulillah, today, to summarize, we spoke about how we must not become Muslim Ramadan Muslims. Do not become the Muslim who only worships during Ramadan, and then after Ramadan, drop everything and go back to your old life. Because the purpose of Ramadan was to increase your ibadah, to build up habits that you can continue to use after Ramadan is over. Alhamdulillah, today we also spoke about how this process does not mean after Ramadan you are a perfect Muslim. No. But after Ramadan, you continue to try to develop small habits that you will maintain so that you make sure that you are not the same Muslim you were last year. We talked about the importance of maintaining the things that we learned during Ramadan. How one of these things was patience. Being patient with the people. Being patient with other people, with your family, with your spouses, with your children. After Ramadan, continue to be patient. Before, during Ramadan, you were saying, you are lucky that I'm fasting. And now after Ramadan, you should say, you are lucky that I am Muslim. We talked about how we must learn to be patient with ourselves. To be patient with your own self-development. And that your path to development is not a one-night journey. But it is going to be a journey where you fall and you rise. You fall and you rise. You make mistakes, you forgive yourself, you ask Allah for forgiveness. And just to make one point, this is something we don't talk about often. When you sin, after you ask Allah for forgiveness, you should forgive yourself as well. Because some of us hold on to it. And then we it's as if you are accusing yourself of doing something that you think you're going to do, but you didn't do it. Just because you did it before doesn't mean you're going to do it again. Forgive yourself. Yes, you've been sinning, but you have what it takes to be a better person. If Allah is willing to forgive you, if Allah believes in you, if Allah knows you will change, if Allah did not believe you would change, then what is the point of astaghfirullah? If Allah did not believe, if Allah said that, okay, if you are a sinner, you're going to remain a sinner, then what's the point of giving us astaghfirullah?
The fact that Allah gave us astaghfirullah is proof that Allah believes in our ability to become better Muslims. And the Sahaba and all the wonderful people who were around the Prophet are proof that the worst people can become the best people. If the people who used to drink and kill for fun can end up becoming Sahaba who would take over when the Prophet is gone, then for sure, then I can definitely become a better Muslim. So we learn that after Ramadan, you must maintain these habits and believe in yourself and know that you actually can become a better Muslim. And that one day you will look back and you'll be proud of yourself. And if you are in the process, if you are in the journey of becoming a better Muslim right now, no matter how small your progress is, even if after 1 year, the most progress you was able to do as a Muslim was that you downloaded Islam Pro, is it? Muslim Pro on your phone. You don't even use it, but you just had the heart to download the app on your phone. Even if that's the only thing you did related to Islam, I'm still proud of you. Why? Because you took the first step. And if you were able to take the first step, I promise you, my brother, my sister, you can definitely continue. And maybe, perhaps, maybe, in the next few years, you will end up being standing here, giving other people advice, giving other people reminders. We ask that Allah Ta'ala increase us all. We ask that Allah Ta'ala make all of what we talked about possible to accomplish. Not only do we ask that Allah grant us Jannah, we ask that Allah give us the courage to seek Jannah itself. We ask that Allah give us all that we need to be able to be successful. We ask that Allah bless and protect the Muslim youth. And that in the future that they will be able to fill up the masajid the way we fill up the masajid now. We ask that Allah Ta'ala increase them in knowledge and increase them in taqwa. We ask that Allah increase all of us in knowledge and increase us in taqwa. We ask that the mistakes that we make, may Allah forgive us. And that which we can correct, may Allah increase us. We have Muslims who are suffering around the world right now. Muslims in India, in China, in Yemen, Palestine especially, we ask that Allah grant them victory. We ask that Allah grant them victory. We ask that Allah grant them victory. We ask that all the pain and suffering that they are going through, may Allah turn it into ajr for them in the day of judgment. And we ask that all the pain and suffering that we go through, may Allah turn it into ajr for us on the day of judgment. Each and every single one of us have a specific issue, a problem, something that is bothering you. Nobody knows about it. You are patient, you keep your mouth quiet, you don't want people to know that this thing is bothering you. Only you and Allah know about this problem. When you go to sleep at night, it is the only thing that disturbs your peace. We ask that Allah, with the power of kun fayakun, that He brings peace to our hearts and deal with this problem for us and make life in this dunya easier for us and make it easier for us to attain His Jannah in the hereafter. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. They say a brother traveled to Africa seeking marriage. May Allah grant him the blessed and most blessed of marriages and allow fruitful children who will benefit the dunya come from that marriage as well. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. And also when they say fi sabilillah, please, please, please invest in your Jannah and continue the sadaqah that we're doing during Ramadan. Donate and donate generously. Fi sabilillah, do not be stingy. Do not let shaitan prevent you from securing your spot in Jannah. We always say we do not know. This may be your last chance to prove to Allah that you want to go to Jannah. Because we do not know when Allah will take our souls. We ask that Allah give us the ability to do so. ربنا اعطنا في الدنيا حسنه وفي الاخره حسنه وقنا عذاب النار وادخلنا الجنه مع الابرار يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين. اللهم صل على نبينا محمد وعلى ال محمد كما صليت على ابراهيم وعلى ال ابراهيم انك حميد مجيد. سبحان ربي رب العزه عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. اكبر الصلاه.
الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. حي الصلاة حي الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
Bestow unto them with trust. If yourself and the arm, please put them on silent or turn them off. Jazakallah khair. Bestow.
Allahu Akbar.
Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون ولا تكونوا كالذين نسوا الله فأنساهم أنفسهم أولئك هم الفاسقون لا يستوي أصحاب النار وأصحاب الجنة أصحاب الجنة هم الفائزون لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا خشية الله وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس لعلهم يتفكرون هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو عالم الغيب والشهادة هو الرحمن الرحيم هو الله الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر سبحان الله عما يشركون هو الله الخالق البارئ المصور له الأسماء يسبح له ما في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر
الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين كن هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
We have ignored the group of justice there before the prayer. So keep him in your dua. He chose the name of Abdul Jalil. So we ask Allah to strengthen him in this path and all of us. Last 3 weeks, we asked for money so that we can pay back what the masjid has to pay during this time of COVID-19. And alhamdulillah, we stand here and we say we want $15,000 just to begin with. But at the end, we realize that we have a lot of people who have heart. They did not write the name, but at the end, we have more than $15,000. So we really, the masjid, the management is presenting his gratitude to all of you. And may Allah keep you safe. May Allah make it a reason for you to have houses in Jannah, inshallah. And during Ramadan, also our sisters and the brothers who pray also, they give a lot of money for the masjid. So that inshallah, alhamdulillah, we can say that the bills we have to pay back, inshallah, we will pay gradually through that money, inshallah. So may Allah reward you, and may Allah keep all of you safe. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Also brothers and sisters who have food, for those who are not fasting, for the 6 days, inshallah, if you have a chance, you have a time, you can stay up to two o'clock for those who are not fasting, inshallah. So we can join together. Thank you.